As an academic, Professor Wood said he would not describe anything that you absolutely could not do. But he said he would like to see if they're going to make that claim, that they would have some explanation for how you turn those tubes into centrifuges. And then there's Joe Turner, who fits the exact opposite profile of Professor Wood in both professionalism and expertise. Turner was a WINPAC analyst, which is the CIA's Center for Weapons Intelligence, Nonproliferation, and Arms Control. That outfit is curiously connected to the entire intelligence debacle. Mr. Turner, you ignored all the experts, yet you offered no coherent case to counter their rock-solid reasoning. Even the best minds in the business seek Professor Wood's advice, and yet you did not. DOE and INR argued that the tubes were a perfect match for the tubes that Iraq had previously purchased for artillery rockets.
No one would waste a costly alloy on a rocket.
The Senate Select Committee on Intelligence investigated this so-called intelligence failure and produced a 511-page document called the Senate Intelligence Report that was released in July 2004. When interviewed by the committee, Department of Defense design engineers who work on rocket systems testified that the national intelligence estimate was not correct at all on your claim. According to the Senate report, high-strength aluminum tube is, around the world, the material choice for low-cost rocket systems because it's widely available and can be easily manufactured and has a high strength-to-weight ratio. U.S. and Russian rocket systems also use the 7075 T6 aluminum, and 13 other countries that manufacture the U.S. Mark 66 also use that same aluminum.
The tubes are suitable for uranium enrichment, and the rocket is less likely the scenario.
What is your argument to support that belief?
The tubes are a near match for the 50-year-old centrifuge designed by the German scientist Gernot Zippe.
Not according to Dr. Zippe. You didn't bother to ask him, but Professor Wood did. And Dr. Zippe replied, not so, not even close.
All the Iraqis had to do was cut the tubes in half for a near match to the Zippe design.
Except that they would still be too heavy, even after cutting them in half. DOE experts told you in 2001 that you failed to include the end caps and a baffle in your calculation of the rotor mass.
But if the Iraqis also shaved the wall thickness down to 1 millimeter, then the mass would match. So, with those modifications, the tubes would work.
You seem to be making it up as you go. You claim that the tightened tolerances indicated the tubes were for centrifuges. Now you're arguing that the walls would have to be machined, which negates your argument on the tolerances. And while theoretically possible to shave the walls to make them work, according to the Red Team paper, it is extremely difficult to machine a high-strength aluminum tube without rendering it useless as a centrifuge rotor. A centrifuge rotor even a few tenths of a millimeter lopsided is going to have significant balancing problems. But even if a rock could pull all that off to perfection, the rotor's separator capacity would be 4 to 5 times less than their proven carbon fiber design.